Hello and welcome to my talk, Routing Android 8 with a Kernel Space Mirroring Attack, which basically will be focused on the security of Android. Firstly, a brief introduction. My name is Wang Yong. I'm a security engineer in Pandora Lab of Alice Security. Currently, I focus on vulnerability hunting and exploitation. Okay, here is the agenda. Today, our first briefly describe the present situation of Android routing. You can say why routing the newly the Android devices is becoming more and more challenging. Then I will discuss a vulnerability in codec with the more constrict SELinux policies and additional sandbox. Compromise the mediacodec daemon is not enough for routing. I will detail how to escape the sandbox and compromise the mediaserver daemon. However, it's just the beginning of another hard work. Next, I will detail a new routing solution revenge. For Android 7, the old public exploitation technique works well. However, those cannot defeat Android 8 due to the new mitigations. So the following, I will introduce a new exploitation technique named kernel space mirroring attack. It's an awesome exploitation technique which enables an attacker to access kernel virtual address from user mode without any syscalls. So it's very easy to bypass both PXN and PN mitigations. With this exploitation technique, the Android 8 devices can be rooted. So the first part, there are two common ways to gain root privilege. The first one is to compromise the kernel through drivers. You can find many vulnerabilities listed in Android Bulletin every month. However, to access a specific driver, you need the first list to compromise the associated privilege process. It's another hard work. Although some universal drivers like a bundler can be accessed directly, there are fewer vulnerabilities. The other one is using a vulnerability in generic syscall. It's attractive, but it's difficult to discover a vulnerability. Most privileged processes like a system server tend to have fewer vulnerabilities than drivers. You may notice there are many vulnerabilities in media framework. For Android 7, one outstanding change is that media server process does not have water capabilities. Those capabilities have been granted to several new daemons. With more straight SELinux policies enforced, less resource can be accessed by a specific privileged process. And due to the exact MAM policy, the shortcode can't be mapped and executed directly, so many LP or GOP gadgets are required. Google has done a great job. Many attack surfaces have been reduced. In 2016, the powerful subsystem has been removed. Through IO control filtering, only a small whitelist of socket IO control commands are available to applications. And now, some syscalls are not reachable from untrusted domain application by secure computing filter. There are new mitigations introduced in Android 8. The first one is privileged access never. For non-tie, redirecting a kernel pointer to user space is a common way to bypass PXN mitigation. But now, a new exploitation technique is required. Without a KASLR mitigation, hard-coded addresses of gadgets are enough for a routing solution. But now, for Android kernel 4.4 and newer, leaking the kernel slide is required. Post-init read-only memory mitigation aims to mitigation reduces the writable memory. That means fewer kernel pointers can be overwritten, making exploitation harder. And the last mitigation aims to help developers spot and fix bugs during testing. So there will be fewer vulnerabilities in drivers. So you can see that Android routing is becoming more and more challenging, but it's still possible. So the second part. Lots of vulnerabilities are listed in Android Bulletin. Here is the match last year. And 1 year later, there are still some vulnerabilities. When users open a major file like MP3 or MP4, it first sends a request to major player. Here is the overview of Android media player. The media executor process extracts the content from one specific format file, and the content will be decoded by the mediacodec process. Another team member, Sun Wei Chao, gave me an MP4 file of 1,000 corps matched last year. The mediacodec process will crash when decoding the file. After testing several tests, a tombstone log attracts my attention. Here, the piece of register is pointed to 18, 18, 18, 18, and this address is invalid, and the backtrace is corrupt. That means some data in the thread stack has been overwritten. Just several days ago, the vulnerability has been fixed and set this CVE number. Here is a common backtrace. According to the backtrace, it's easy to find this function. During format converting, the input data will be copied to the output buffer, and the file parameters determine the start offset and the length when copying. After analyzing the source code, I found the file parameters are all controllable. The first two are determined by the width and height of MP4 file, and the other three are determined by the width and height of Luma sample picture, which can be read from the HVCC box of the MP4 file. And if the memory copy complements, another format callback will also be invoked. In this callback, another formatted data will also be copied to the output buffer, so the decoding thread may also crash in the function. In the first init call, the Numa and the Chroma buffers are filled with 128. That's why some crash logs show the PC register is pointing to the invalid address. To exploit the bug, it requires skipping the stack guard page and overwriting some metadata in the thread stack during copying. For one thread, the internal structure is saved in the bottom of the stack. When a thread exists, the cleanup handles will be invoked, and the stack buffer overflow protection is enabled to avoid corrupting the canary value and triggering the stack check guard routine. Overwriting this cleanup stack pointer is simple and useful to hijack the thread. After converging, the data of the three value channels will be copied to the output buffer. During the copy, the start offset, the number of items, the size of items and the interviews for each channel are shown in the table. The four parameters are based on the width and height of MP4 file and the width and height of Luma sample picture. So to skip the guard page and overwrite the cleanup stack pointer, the width and height should be properly set. Here the offset the offset of the last item is equal to it. And the most important thing is that none of the items is copied to the guard page. For each channel, this inequality must be satisfied. And for which channel, the inequality is similar. So after solving the equations, I found there are many available combinations. In my exploit code, I chose the last one. Here is the ideal memory layout. Although the base address of mediacodec is unknown due to the ASLR mitigation, this address must be invalid. So a large size of input buffer can be used to control the value of the address. In fact, there are many holes in memory layout. Crushing those media processes like mediaserver, mediacodec, or mediaexecutor do not lead to system reboot. So to avoid filling the memory holes, crushing the server is first to shape the layout is not a poor choice. Here, after the last item of that channel being copied, you can see the cleanup stack pointer has been overwritten. The register is set to this magical number, and the code will load the value of this address into R1 register. Next, the PC register will be controlled when calling a subroutine at an address specific in R1 register. Here the thread is controlled. For mediaexecutor and mediacodec process, the mediajail is enabled, which is based on the secure computing. Here only several syscalls are available. It's not enough to compromise the kernel. So in Android, the decoding procedure is based on the open media acceleration framework. Before sending a request to media codec process, it first requires getting the OMX handle. It's interesting that the media player service also have an OMX handle. That means there is a chance to decode media fields in media server process. In OMX client, this function determines the default codec process. So you can hook the function and make a media server as the default one. And the most important point is there is no mediajail enabled in media server process. That means you can escape the secure computing sandbox and compromise the media server process. You may ask how to hook the function. Just the self-modifying code. The steps are simple. Find the vtable of this class and replace the function pointer in the exploitation process. So with other information disclosure vulnerabilities, one thread of middle server can be easily controlled. Here is the demo. So now, one thread of media server is controlled. However, it's just the beginning of another hard work for routing. Due to the exact memory policy, the thread can't allocate RWX attributes memory for the shortcode. That means the exploitation code for stage 2 must be rewritten by ILP format. So many, many gadgets are required. And the most important point is that we still have fewer drivers can be accessed. So you can see that why the vulnerability in generic Cisco is attractive. Let me detail a routine solution based on a vulnerability in generic Cisco. Revenge is based on saving 2075.33. This vulnerability is discovered as a bug by my colleague Lin Lele, another department. And the public disclosure was released in August last year. At that time, most of the Android devices are shipped with kernel 3.18 to 4.4, so this vulnerability does impact Android. Since most devices are 34-bit, whether it's exploitable or not is unknown. It's a user-free vulnerability due to the race condition. When winning the race, some data of the last slab object can be overwritten. Since it's associated with rename and notification event syscalls, this routine solution is named as a revenge. The vulnerability exists in this function to trigger the vulnerable callback. It first requires to add a monitor to one field with some specific actions like in access. When those actions are triggered, this callback will be invoked. At point 1, calculate lambda's length and allocation size. At point 2, allocate a buffer for the event. And at the point 3, copy the lambda to the buffer. The problem is that a contact switch can happen between point 1 and point 3. That means this field can be renamed, and the length of the field name is outdated. Here is the sequence diagram. Thread 1 triggers the notification and calculates the length. Then contact switch thread 2 renames the field. The old name is freed by RSU callback. Subsequently, the freed buffer is refilled with the payload data and contact switch again. The allocated buffer is not enough for the long bytes now, so a heap overflow can occur. Here is the associated heap layout. First, the field name is composed of 200A. The size of I notify event information structure is 48 bytes. So the length of the buffer is 249 bytes. Then the field is renamed and the old name is freed and refilled. So the last object will be partially overwritten during string copying. To exploit the bug, there are two main problems required to solve. The first one is to find a proper victim object. The object must have a kernel pointer in the head. And after string copying, a zero byte is added at the end. So it requires the object being immune to this side effect. Another problem is heap feng shui. The field name, notification event, payload data, and the victim object are all allocated in the same heap. And the victim object is required to be allocated less to the vulnerable event. After searching kernel data structures, I decided to compromise PIPO subsystem to gain arbitrary kernel memory overwriting. The reason is the time of check to time of use feature can make exploitation easier. When reading a PIPO field with read with Cisco, it first allocates a buffer, copies LVX to the kernel, and checks boundary. Then the PIPO read callback will be invoked. If no data is available, the reading thread will block in the callback. when some data is written in the pipe, the ready thread will be woken up and continue to copy data to the buffer. You can see there is no other boundary check during copying. So LVX as the ideal victor object, since LV length can be set to a small value like 8, overwriting the LV base to a kernel address does not bring any side effect. That means low corrupt data required to recover, and here almost arbitrary write ability is gained, but there are some limitations. If a target kernel address contains 0 bytes, it can't be written. Fortunately, there are many ideal core bank pointers in kernel data section. Since only one L-vector object is not enough for exploitation, lots of reading threads are required, but the number of the threads is limited. Here is the ideal heap layout during exploiting. First, spread lots of L-vector objects in the heap here. Then, free the half of the L-vector objects and shape the heap like this. Let's spawn some threads to race. When winning the race, the LV base of the first L vector is pointed to the target kernel address. And then now we can write this kernel address. In fact, there are many freed buffer holes in the heap. Before spreading the L vector objects, those holes are required to fill, because a notification event can stay in the kernel until reading. The event object is a proper candidate. After filling the host with the events, the slab allocator will return an empty list for L-vector objects. When two same actions are triggered subsequently, notification subsystem will merge the two events into one event and free the second event object directly. So when filling a freed buffer holes, two different actions can be used alternatively, avoiding merging. During racing, the freed L-vector buffers are not enough since lots of events are allocated. Merging the events can help improve the success rate. A public method to bypass PXM mitigation and gain arbitrary read-write ability is hijacking the check flag kernel pointer. And since the lower 13 bits of X0 register are controllable, the simple GOP chain can be easily constructed. For Android 7 and lower devices, the exploitation steps are straightforward. First, prepare the resource like GOP chain, pipe fill descriptors, and notification monitor. And fill the buffer holes of the heap. Then spawn reading threads and shape the heap with L-vector objects. Let's spawn read threads and do check in the main thread. If winning the race, the arbitrary read-write ability is gained. The last step is overwrite UID and disable SELinux and spawn a root shell. But for Android 8 devices like PX2, the game rule has changed. The KASLR mitigation is enabled in kernel 4.4. To execute the GOP gadgets, the kernel slide must be leaked first. And the PN mitigation is fully implemented, so the data for GOP chain should be written into the kernel. To calculate the kernel slide, leaking a kernel function or data pointer is enough. The data of an event buffer can be read through notification, monitor field descriptor. So springing a special kind of object instead of payload data may leak the kernel address information. Since the name field is at the offset 16 of external name structure, it requires this special object has such a pointer. Unfortunately, no such object was found. After a few days, I decided to find an object which only has a kernel pointer at that offset. Then I found the old friend notification event has an iload pointer. And the iload objects are allocated in a ladder heap. And if iload structure has an iload operation callback. So there are two stages to calculate the kernel slide. At stage one, use the event object to spring. When winning the race, it can leak a kernel heap pointer. Like previous exploitation steps, read the iload field, iop field of this iload at the stage two. Another PM mitigation for Android 8 devices is also required to bypass. Here with PAN enabled, the GOP chain to bypass PX mentioned previously can't work. Here the only the lower 32 bits are controllable, and the PAN will block the access to a user address. So another IOP or GOP chain is required to bypass both PX and PN mitigations. It's not difficult to find a chain that the X0 register is fully controllable. The problem is that writing additional payload into the kernel for GOP chain increase the crash rate during exploiting. So the CVE 2017-13164 discovered by me in 2016 can help solve the problem. It's born with bundle driver and it can leak a kernel address filled with alien payload reliably. But my goals are only a vulnerability used, no LP or GOP chain required, and both PX and PN mitigations fully bypassed. To achieve those goals, let me introduce a new kernel exploitation technique, kernel space mirroring attack. This is the classical page table layout of Linux. There are three separate levels of the page table. Page global director, page middle director, and page table entry. When a process accesses a virtual address, the virtual address will be broken up its component paths for navigating those three tables. In fact, the translation follow is automatically completed by memory management unit. The address translation of ARMv8 is complicated. For Android, the translation follow is showing the red figure. The page size is 4 kilobyte granule and 512 gigabyte virtual addresses are for both user and kernel. And the three levels of translation tables are configured. So the translation follow is starting at the level one. The base address of translation tables are saved in the TTBRX registers. TTBRX selection is given by the bit 63 of the virtual address. Here are the descriptor formats for level 0, level 1, and level 2. There are two types of formats, table and a block here. If the level one lookup or level two lookup returns a block descriptor, then the translation table work complements at that level. Otherwise, the less level lookup is required. That means a block descriptor is used to describe a memory region with the same attributes. This descriptor format is only for level 3, the last level. Here is the general view of address translation. You can see that if a block descriptor is returned, the translation will complement immediately. For Android, there is low-level 0 table. There are some attribute fields for both block and page descriptors. The unprivileged execute never bit determines whether the region is executable or not in the same translation regime. The PXN bit determines whether the region is executable at the exception level 1. The AP2 bits determine whether the region can be read or written or both. Here are the four combinations of permissions for exception level 1 and exception level 0 translation regime. The 00 combination can be used for kernel data region, and the 10 is for kernel test region. But the other two combinations seem useless. A kernel address could never be read or written by a user process. And for a user address, the PN mitigation blocks the access at the exception level 1. The 0-1 combination attracts my attention. It can provide a way to access a kernel virtual address at exception level 0 directly. That means both PX and PN mitigations can be easily bypassed with this ability. But after analyzing the kernel page table of some Android devices, the 0-1 combination has never appeared. The general way to modify the attributes of a given kernel address has three steps. First, look up each level of the page tables. Then, find the address of the associated page table entry. And finally, set the 0-1 combination. To work the page table, the arbitrary read-write ability is required. If you already have this ability, overwriting the UID and spawning a root shell is straightforward. The game is over. The question is, do you really need to work the page table? Suppose a phone with 3 GB RAM without KASLR mitigation enabled. A common layout of a level 1 table is shown in the figure. There are three valid entries. Since the access permission of a kernel test region is different from the permission of a kernel data region, so the first valid entry returns a table descriptor while working. Usually, this memory region is invalid, so the entry is opening. Suppose there is a block descriptor for this region. The output address of this block descriptor is pointing to the first 1 GB physical memory, and the access permission bits are 0-1. Normally, this physical address can be accessed from this virtual address at exception level 1. But now it can be accessed from this kernel virtual address. And the most important thing is that this virtual address can be read or written at exception level 0. That means no read-write primitives are required to access the kernel. The kernel isolation has been broken. This is the principle of KSMA exploitation technique. So to add a special block descriptor, you need to know the start virtual address of level 1 table. In the Linux kernel, swapper page director is the kernel page global director. For the kernel mirroring base, the virtual address of the table entry can be calculated by this simple expression. And with this formula, the mirroring kernel virtual address can be easily converted. With the KASLR mitigation enabled, the only difference is that it requires the kernel slide to calculate the real virtual address of a swapper page director. The other things are the same. Here are the exploitation steps for Android 8. At stage 1 and stage 2, link kernel heap and data pointers, calculate the kernel slide as mentioned previously. And stage 3, first prepare a special block descriptor and calculate the associated entry address. Then spawn race threads. After winning the race, disable SELinux and patch SECCOMP from user mode. Finally, invoke the patched SECCOMP and spawn a root shell. With this KSMA exploitation technique, you can see that there is no ILP or GLP chain used, and both PXR and PNN mitigations are fully bypassed. Also, the post-init read-only memory constraint can be also bypassed. You may ask how to patch the SECCOMP. Here is the example. To access one kernel virtual address, it requires to converting the address to the mirroring address. Then you can read-write this mirroring kernel virtual address like the user virtual address without any syscalls. Here is we direct write 0 value to kernel data, and here we patch a syscall. So for ARMv7, this exploitation technique can also work well. The section descriptor is very similar to the block descriptor of ARMv8. Meanwhile, the combination 0-1 also allows accessing kernel memory at exception level 0. Since the idea is very similar, I will not discuss again. Here is the demo. The phone is Google Pixel 2 XL with all the mitigations of Android 8 enabled. We'll be right back. the last part. In my talk, a value-way exploitation for mediaserver is detailed. A new reliable root exploitation technique like KSMA is introduced, which can break Android kernel isolation and bypass both PX and PM mitigations of Android 8. Nowadays, Android routing is becoming more and more challenging, but it's still possible. Here are the references. So, any questions? Thank you and enjoy the conference.
So, are we opening up the questions on the floor? Anybody questions?
Hi, thanks for the talk. Do you have tested if KSMR is still possible when applying these KPTI patches where you isolate the kernel page tables due to mitigations of Spectre and Meltdown?
Actually, in my idea, this exploitation technique is based on the tiny improper design of hardware. I have discussed with Concon engineer to wait a minute to remove this combination. It's useless. So last month I talked with engineer of Google. It seems since it's derived from the hardware, so the software mitigation may not block this exploitation technique. Yeah.
All right. Anyone else? No questions? All right. Thank you very much, Wang Yu.